president of the college, I am honored by the visit of today's speakers. During Black History Month, we are truly fortunate to be hearing from two of our state's leading legislative representatives, State Senate President Emil Jones Jr. and newly elected United States Senator Barack Obama. Let me take just a moment to introduce to you the members of our Moraine Valley Board of Trustees who are here with us this morning. Trustee Sandy Wagner, Board Chair. Trustee Patricia Roach, Board Vice Chair. Trustee John J. Daly, Board Secretary. We also have some members of our board, Foundation Board, here with us today. Would they please stand and be acknowledged? We are pleased to acknowledge the presence of our state senators as well this morning. Senator Lou Barbarito, stand up, please. Senator Debbie Patterson. And Senator Abe Maloney. We welcome all of you to a college that is the second largest college in the state with an annual enrollment of over 46,000 students. It is among the fastest growing community colleges in the nation. It is one of the 12 Vanguard Learning Colleges in North America competitively selected by the Pew Foundation. It offers more than 100 degrees and certificates. Offers outstanding transfer and career programs. Through a grant from the National Science Foundation, is a regional center for systems security and information assurance, serving six Midwest states. And lastly, but not least, we have the finest faculty and staff in the nation. Choose Moraine Valley as their place for further education. One of our honored speakers today made history last November when he became only the third African American since Reconstruction era to be elected to the United States Senate. You will hear from Senator Obama very shortly. State Senate President Emil Jones Jr. was recently elected by his colleagues to serve his second term as leader of the Illinois Senate. I'm sure Senator Jones will agree with me on the importance of what we do at Moraine Valley. You see, he too attended a community college, having graduated from what was once known as Luke Junior College, now Earl Washington College, one of the city colleges of Chicago. Last year, Senator Jones was officially inducted as a member of Phi Theta Kappa, the International Honor Society for students attending two-year colleges. Again, ladies and gentlemen, welcome to Moraine Valley, and thank all of you for being here this morning. It is now my pleasure to introduce Shonita Boyd. Shonita is president of the Alliance of African American Students here at Moraine Valley. Please welcome her as she introduces Senate President Emil Jones.
Good morning. My name is Shonita Bowen. I am the president of the Alliance of African American Students. Black History Month has a special meaning to me. This is a specific time of the year to recognize and celebrate the richness of a nation of people who have and leaders in elevating and defining our country in the political sciences, mathematics, biological and natural sciences, and language and creative arts. Furthermore, it is a time to reflect on significant historical dynamics that impacted our ancestors to ensure that we honor their struggles through our educational and societal advances, although it's the shortest, most overlooked, and least acknowledged month of the year to celebrate a heritage so vast and colorful. Despite our struggles, we have continued to persevere, overcome obstacles, emerge from trials, and excel triumphantly, yet with the wisdom to recognize the struggle still continues. It's my honor to welcome Illinois Senate President Emil Jones Jr. to our campus again. The Honorable Senate President Emil Jones Jr. has been a member of the Illinois General Assembly since 1973 and a member of the State Senate since 1982. On January 12, 2005, Senator Emil Jones Jr. received the unanimous support of the members of the Senate Democratic Caucus to be elected the Senate President in the 94th General Assembly, this being his second term as the Senate's chief presiding officer. Senator Jones has been a strong supporter of education issues throughout his service in the Illinois General Assembly. Senator Jones also fought for and passed legislation to double the personal exemption on state income tax to benefit working families. For his legislative and community endeavors, Senator Jones has received numerous awards from educational, business, and labor organizations, among others. It is my pleasure to introduce the Honorable Senate President Emil Jones Jr., an outstanding champion of education in Illinois.
Thank you very much, and good morning to all. Bright faces, and I can see why it's a great university, because students get up this early to come to school. Dr. Crawley, your president, as well as all the board of trustees, it's an honor to come back to Moraine Valley once again. I was here once before, twice, and my good friend over here sitting down in front of the red blouse on, she said, Willow. And before I got elected, she told me, she said, no, Black History Month, be happy, you must have Barack Obama. I didn't want to ask him. And the reason why I didn't want to ask him, out of respect to my friend, I recognize that he received over 200 requests per week for appearances. So I didn't want to bother him with that. I know we get a lot of work, but I'm so pleased and honored that he decided to come to Moraine Valley this morning. Chairman of the Education Committee in the Illinois Senate, and he's the one that controls prevention programs. I met him at that early age. I think he was about 21, 22. And we had the pleasure of serving with him in the Illinois Senate. So I give to you your U.S. Senator, our friend, our colleague, I give to you my good friend, Senator Barack Obama.
Civil rights movement, but we have to say that you know, things are just tougher now than they were then, I think, to get involved in the civil rights struggle, because things were so much clearer then than they are now. It's easy to know which side to be on when there are dogs and fire hoses and a clear injustice. It's so much more difficult when the problem is not whether or not somebody can sit at the lunch counter to eat, but whether they're going to have a job to have enough money to eat. It's so much easier to confront issues of oppression of the sort that Bull Connors represented. It's a lot harder to figure out what do we do about young men and young women who've lost hope and are engaged in the drug trade. How do we bring them back? Yeah, the questions to a lot of young people seem more complex, more difficult now than they did during the civil rights movement. So people get discouraged, and they end up not getting involved in any public life. They don't even bother to cast a ballot, despite the enormous efforts that were made by their parents and their grandparents to ensure that they would have the franchise. And one of the things that I remind students of is that although during February Black History Month or during Dr. King's birthday, we celebrate the great changes that have been wrought in our nation as if they were inevitable, the fact is that it's always been complicated and it's always been difficult to try to perfect this union of ours. Things have never been easy. People don't remember that Dr. King was extraordinarily controversial, not just in the white community, where he was deemed an outsider and an agitator and a communist, but in the African-American community, where fellow ministers, when he came to Chicago, fellow African-American ministers, President Jones will remember this, fellow African-American ministers accused him of meddling. There was one pastor who disliked him so much that he changed the address of his church when his church was sitting on what is now known as King Boulevard. And when it was named King Boulevard, he changed the address of his church to the side street so that he would not have his church associated with Dr. King. He's an African-American minister. I mean, we don't remember how controversial the tactics of the civil rights movement were. The idea of nonviolent protest and sending young people out to march, putting them in harm's way. There were a lot of people who said, you're rushing things. This doesn't make sense. Things have to be done in an orderly fashion. People were accused of fomenting violence. And yet, people decided to go ahead and take those steps and make those changes and march towards freedom. And I make that point, I guess, to say that part of our struggle, I think, today, whether we are white or black or Asian or Jew or Arab, is to constantly keep in mind that for us to try to achieve a better world for ourselves and our families and our communities and our nation and this world requires us to take risks and push the envelope and work a little bit harder than we ever thought was possible. And it also, I think, requires us to keep in mind that the measure of our greatness as a nation is not the height of our skyscrapers or our GNP, but it's rather how do we tend to the most vulnerable in our society? The children, the infirm, the aged. We have to have an orientation and a set of values that makes us willing to take risks. And we have to internalize some of the things that a lot of times we give lip service to, but don't always actively pursue and work towards. Everybody's for education, but are we willing to actually make the sacrifices to make sure that all the young people here have the kinds of student loans that allow them to pursue an education? Are we willing to invest? Everybody's for education, yes, but are we willing to put the money in to follow up on what we opportunity. And yet, the fact of the matter is that children are some of the poorest folks in our society. And we are consistently selling them short in terms of providing them with early childhood education and providing them health care. We say that we honor our senior citizens. And yet, as I travel around the state, again and again I meet senior citizens who are confronted with health care that is inadequate, with prescription drug programs that they can't afford. And now we have the prospect that the next generation of seniors may not have the kinds of retirement security that so many had come to expect and is a cornerstone of what makes this nation great. And so it's not enough for us to just say that we care about these things. We have to work for these things. And we have to take risks for these things. And occasionally we have to engage in some conflict. Not violent conflict, but the sort of conflict that our democracy allows, our willingness to challenge what is in order to achieve what might be. Now, for young people, as you pursue what I hope will be careers that aren't just making you a lot of money, although making money is nothing wrong with that, but also give you a sense that you are part of this larger conversation about how we make our country better, there are just a couple principles that I would ask you to consider, because I think that they've helped guide me in terms of doing the work that I've done. The first is the simple principle that no man is an island, and no woman is an island, and that you only will achieve significance to the extent that you're involved with something larger than yourself. You know, sometimes when I meet young people whose main aspiration is a nice ride or a lot of fancy clothes or a fancy apartment, I say to myself, you know, that displays a certain poverty of ambition. Everybody has that ambition. That's not very interesting to be rich. All of you have so much more talent than that, that I hope that you're thinking in terms of what's possible if you participate in something larger than yourself. And that doesn't mean that you have to run for public office. That doesn't mean you have to be a speech maker like Dr. King. Without Rosa Parks sitting when they asked her to stand, there would be no Dr. King. Without people like E.J. Nixon and Ella Baker and Fannie Lou Hamer, there is no civil rights movement. Ordinary people doing extraordinary things. Women who are willing to walk instead of ride the bus home after doing a full day's work, doing somebody else's laundry and looking after somebody else's children, and yet still willing to walk home day in, day out, because they thought that they could pass on freedom to their children. That's the kind of involvement that we need. You know, we live in this privatized society where everything is private. Private schools, private clubs, even our religion sometimes is private. You know, folks sit home and watch television instead of going to church. But part of what I'm suggesting to you is you won't achieve your full potential unless you're involved in something larger than yourself. And it's not a guilt trip. I say that not because you owe a debt to people who helped you get to where you are, although you do owe that debt. It's not because you have an obligation to those who are less fortunate, although you do have that obligation. It's mainly because you have an obligation to yourself. Because I think you can do more than any previous generation has been able to achieve in terms of making improvements in this country. The second principle I want you guys to just keep in mind is the principle of empathy. You know, during February Black History Month, I hope we don't forget that we live in a society where there are a whole bunch of folks around from different places, from different walks of life, and that part of what Black history should teach us is not simply to value Black history, but rather remind us to value everybody's history. You know, I country's life, then for us to be able to understand each other and stand in other people's shoes. Because part of what makes this country great is that we have all these threads from different places, from different walks of life, different cultures, different ethnicities, different religions. And the only way we're going to make progress, black, white, brown, is if we in fact can recognize ourselves in each other. And that's always been how we've made progress. When the founders of this country declared independence, they didn't say we hold these truths to be self-evident, that some people are created equal. They said all men are created equal. Now they left out women, they left out African Americans, but the concept of our charter was that all people, we can speak in universal terms about everybody's aspirations. The same is true when Dr. King stood on the steps of the Lincoln Memorial. He didn't stand up there and say, I have a dream that one day some people or some children will stand together and hold hands in brotherhood. That's not what he said. He didn't say it's a black thing, you can't understand. He said, it's a human thing. Of course you can understand. That notion that we can see ourselves in each other, and that when you see a child on the street corner, abandoned, neglected, that's in some fashion your child. When you see a senior citizen without the kinds of care that they need, that in some sense is your grandparent, that basic idea is what makes our country work. Which leads me to the third and final principle, which I think is important. And that is the principle of hope. You know, during the course of this election, I was traveling all across the state of Illinois. And one of the areas that I had to spend a lot of time in, because it wasn't an area that I had been campaigning when I was in the state senate, was downstate Illinois and southern Illinois. And so I ended up going to 19 cities in 3 days after the primary here. 19 cities in 3 days. All through southern Illinois. I mean, we went to Edwardsville and Caseyville and Hillsboro and Murfreesboro. We went to every hill and borough and ville in southern Illinois. And Dick Durbin accompanied our great senior United States Senator, now minority whip in the Senate. He was very generous with his time, and so he was traveling with me. And one of our stops was in the city of Cairo, Illinois. And for those of you who are not aware, Cairo is at the southernmost tip of Illinois, right on the border of Kentucky. And Cairo also achieved a certain infamy during the 60s and early 70s as one of the locations of the worst racial strife of anywhere in the country. Anywhere in the country. It was nationally known for its racial problems. And as we were driving down there, Dick Durbin and I started to talk about the history of Cairo. And Dick Durbin said, yeah, the first time I went to Cairo, I remember I was about 23 years old. I had just gotten out of law school and I was working for this guy with big ears and a bow tie, who was then the lieutenant governor named Paul Simon. And Paul Simon had dispatched Dick Durbin to investigate the racial situation down there. Because there had been all sorts of stuff going on. There had been cross burnings and riots and all the racial stuff that you think about during those late 60s, early 70s years. And so Dick Durbin, you know, traveled down there. He's a young lawyer. He's going to investigate. He gets down to Cairo and gets off the train or the bus. And there's a local guy who's picking him up and driving him to the hotel. And he says, he drops Dick Durbin off in front of the motel where Durbin's going to be staying, but he turns to him and he says, listen, young man, I just want to give you a piece of advice. Durbin says, what's that? He says, don't use the telephone in your motel room. He says, why not? He says, because the White Citizens Council, which was the equivalent of the Ku Klux Klan at that time, the person who works the switchboard is a member of the White Citizens Council and is going to report on everything that you say, your big watch. Well, this intimidates Dick Durbin. He's only 23, but brave young man. He goes ahead and checks in. He goes up to his room, starts unpacking. Suddenly, here's a knock on the door. Opens up the door. There's a guy standing there. He's looking at me. Doesn't say anything, doesn't introduce himself. Finally, the guy just says, what the heck are you doing here? And then walks away. Well, now Durbin's really feeling intimidated. And so am I, because as he's telling me the story, we're pulling into Cairo. So we go past the old courthouse and we're winding through the streets, and suddenly we come across this parking lot. And big parking lot, there are about 300 people standing there. And they all look to be of an age in which they would have been active participants in this active struggle that was taking place back in the early 70s, the late 60s. And as we get closer, we notice that about a third of the crowd is black, and about two-thirds of the crowd is white. And then we get a little bit closer, and we notice that they're all wearing these little blue buttons that say, Obama for U.S. Senate. And they're waving, and they're smiling, and they're clapping, and I look at Dick Durbin, and he looks at me, and we don't have to say anything because we know what the other person's thinking. If you had told Dick Durbin 30 years ago, 40 years ago, that one day he, the son of a Lithuanian immigrant, dirt poor in East St. Louis, would be returning to Cairo, Illinois, as the senior United States Senator, and that he would have with him a black guy, born in Hawaii, who had a father from Kenya and a mother from Kansas, named Barack Obama, and that he was the Democratic nominee for U.S. Senate, nobody would have believed it. It would have been impossible. And yet here it was happening, which just reminds us of what Dr. King once said, my favorite quote of his. He said, the arc of the moral universe is long, but it bends towards justice. It bends towards justice, but it doesn't bend on its own. It bends because each and every one of us are willing to put our arms and hands on that arc and to bend it in that direction. Even when it seems like change can't happen, even when it seems like it's hopeless to put people back to work, even when it seems like because of global competition, it's going to be hard for us to achieve the same standard of living as our parents, even when it appears that racial strife and religious strife, it is inevitable, somehow people are willing to put their hand on that arc and bend it towards justice. And if everybody here internalizes that, believes that, feels that sense of hope, then I'm absolutely convinced that this country is going to continue along that arc towards justice, and we will, in fact, someday arrive at that more perfect union. Thank you very much, everybody.
How are you, sir?
Good. Higher education funding, I'm the president of this. What's your name? Brandon. Okay. How you doing? Higher education under funding under President Bush's budget proposal for 2006 appeared to take a huge cut in programs that support access and academic support. For example, the Parkinson grant, which supports the TRIO program. Now, with that said, how will you help them understand the need to reinvest in programs that promote students' access and success in public state institutions?
Well, I don't know how much I can change George Bush's mind about things. But what I can do is try to change, I think, the voters' perceptions that then hopefully put some pressure on the administration and the Congress to redouble our commitment to higher education. I'll tell you just a brief story. I was having lunch with a man named Tom Friedman, who's a columnist for the New York Times and has written a lot of books on the global economy. This was just this week. And he had just come back from India, where a lot of the outsourcing is taking place in terms of computer jobs and other higher education jobs. And there's a particular town called Bangalore, which is where some of the fastest growing high-tech companies in the world are being built up. And the admissions director, the human resources person at this major company, which is sort of the IBM, Microsoft of India, said to him while he was visiting that for 9,000 jobs, that they have across openings that they have, and they're growing in leaps and bounds. For 9,000 jobs that they have across India, they've received 1 million applications. To 1 million people who have computer training, right? 1 million for 9,000 jobs. And it just gives you some sense of the kind of competition that all of us are going to be facing in the years to come. The time is over when, you know, the United States worker can kind of sit back and take it easy because there are a bunch of these poor countries out there that can't make anything and they're just selling us, you know, cocoa beans or what have you. I mean, folks are catching up. And what that means is that we have to invest, we have to redouble our investment in our young people. Now, I've got a set of specific proposals in terms of increasing Pell Grants, improving the terms in which people take out low-rate loans, but that's not reflecting the president's budget, which means that part of the task is for everybody here to help